During this presentation, we'll be going over UDOT Standard Drawing TC3 series for hazard mitigation and positive protection devices used within work zones. Here you can see Standard Drawing TC3A hazard mitigation and TC3B hazard mitigation and positive protection devices. 23 CFR, or Code of Federal Regulations, Section 630, Subpart K, requires the department to adopt a finalized set of rules on how to implement positive protection for workers within a work zone. We provide this by properly placing positive protection devices. Positive protection devices include devices that contain and/or redirect vehicles and meet crashworthiness criteria, such as portable concrete barrier, ballast field barriers, steel barriers, movable barrier, shadow vehicles with attenuators, and vehicle arresting systems. Standard Drawing TC3A directs the user to the new decision sheet TC3B for positive protection. Standard Drawing TC3B has been developed to address federal regulations regarding the protection of workers within a work zone. This drawing will come into play when you determine that you have a Type C hazard, workers, or non-flaggers, as shown on TC3A. Let's take a look at TC3A. Each section of this drawing is referenced throughout the TC series, so it is important that you become familiar with this drawing. The drawing includes three sections: Detail TC3A1, Hazard Mitigation Chart; Detail TC3A2, that deals with hazard type E, vertical drop-off hazards; Table 1 deals with work clear zones; and Table 2 deals with work zone flare rates for temporary barrier. Let's go over Detail TC3A1. Here is where you determine the type of hazard and how to handle it. A Type A hazard, non-working equipment or vehicles; a Type B hazard, stockpiled material; a Type C hazard is a working vehicle or workers, which do not include flaggers; Type D hazard is other objects and features such as bridge parapets, barrier blunt ends, and poles; Type E hazard, which is slope steeper than 4:1, or vertical drop-off of less than 48 inches. First question: can the hazard be removed or relocated outside the astral clear zone, or can the drop-off be flattened to 5:1 or flatter? Before you spend too much time determining the type of hazard, we want to know if it can be moved outside the astral clear zone. Bottom line, if the hazard can be moved, remove it. If the hazard cannot be removed, is the hazard Type A or Type B, which is non-working equipment or stockpiled material? If you determine that it is, then can it be removed? If yes, then will the hazard be used within 24 hours? If no, then the hazard must be removed. Let's back up a bit. Can the hazard be moved? If no, then protect with barrier and see Table 2 to ensure that it is placed at the correct flare rate. If hazard will be used within 24 hours, then move the hazard 2 times the work clear zone according to Table 1. Remember, according to the MUTCD Chapter 6B, all temporary traffic control devices shall be removed as soon as practical. Let's take a look at a Type A hazard. If the equipment is not being used, then it is an unnecessary hazard to the traveling public and needs to be moved outside the astral clear zone or outside the UDOT right-of-way. Here you have stockpiled material, which is a Type B hazard. Because the material is unable to be placed outside the astral clear zone, barrier has been installed. Barrier would also be required to provide positive protection for workers, the blunt end, and drop-off protection. As you can see, the stockpiled material was placed outside the astral clear zone, as stated in the roadside design guide. You have determined that the hazard cannot be moved outside the astral clear zone and that the hazard is not a Type A or B hazard. You have determined that the hazard is a Type C hazard, workers, non-flaggers. The chart refers us to Standard Drawing TC3B to determine the use of required positive protection devices for workers in work zones. Now let's look at TC3B, Hazard Mitigation and Positive Protection Devices. First, let's look at the notes. Notes 1 and 2 provide a definition for positive protection devices and what they include. Notes 3 provide work duration definitions. These definitions match those found in the MUTCD. Now let's look at some work site conditions and work through this table. This table has 4 factors that you need to consider. Under each factor, choose which condition best describes the work zone. The points accumulated will determine what action needs to be taken. Take a look at the photograph on the lower right-hand side. Let's say the contractor will finish the wall in this location within 2 months. In this instance, what condition would you choose? long-term stationary for 6 points. What is the exposure for the worker? Let's take a look at TC3A Table 1 for the work clear zone requirements. This roadway has a posted speed of 65 miles per hour for a work clear zone of 8.5 feet. With that in mind, we know that all workers can perform their duties outside twice the work clear zone. That would give us 3 points. Next, we know the posted speed of 65 miles per hour for 10 points. Factor 4, location of work. The area is open and workers have multiple escape routes for 0 points. Now we have 19 accumulated points. Now let's look at the results. With the accumulated points being less than 20 points, we are required to use standard traffic control devices. Keep in mind that stockpiled material must remain outside the astral clear zone to avoid having blunt-end issues. Let's take a look at the scenario as shown on the shoulder widening operation photograph. This project will take up to a month to complete. Knowing the project will take a month, we will choose long-term stationary work with duration of more than 3 days to less than 3 months. This will give us 6 points. Next, what is the exposure of the worker? Let's take a look at TC3A Table 1 for the work clear zone requirements. This roadway has a posted speed of 60 miles per hour for a work clear zone of 8 feet. That being the case, we would choose workers are expected to be inside the work clear zone for 10 points. Next, we know the posted speed of 60 miles per hour for 10 points. Factor 4, location of work. The area is open and workers have multiple escape routes for 0 points. Now we have 26 accumulated points. Let's look at the results. Positive protection devices or other mitigation efforts and standard traffic control are required to mitigate worker exposure. Mitigation will include, at a minimum, one of the following. Providing positive protection devices. Reducing traffic device spacing to a maximum of 1/2 the required device spacing. Providing a buffer space and or providing a truck-mounted attenuator. In this case, we would choose number 2. Reduce traffic spacing to a maximum of 1/2 the required device spacing. According to TC4 series, the maximum allowed device spacing is 120 feet. Take this number and divide it by 2. This will provide the maximum required device spacing of 60 feet. This project will take up to 1 month to complete. Again, we will go over the 4 factors. Knowing that this project will take a month, we will choose long-term stationary work with duration of more than 3 days to less than 3 months. This will give us 6 points. What is the exposure of the worker? Let's look at TC3A Table 1 for the work clear zone requirements. This road has a posted speed of 70 miles per hour for a work clear zone of 9 feet. This being the case, we would choose workers are expected to be inside the work clear zone for 10 points. Next, we know the posted speed of 70 miles per hour for 10 points. Factor 4, location of work. The area is open and workers have multiple escape routes for 0 points. Now we have 26 accumulated points. Let's look at the results. Positive protection devices or other mitigation efforts and standard traffic control are required to mitigate worker exposure. Mitigation will include, at a minimum, one of the following. Providing positive protection devices. Reducing traffic device spacing to a maximum of 1/2 the required device spacing. Providing a buffer space and or providing a truck-mounted attenuator. In this case, we would choose number 2. Reduce traffic spacing to a maximum of 1/2 the required device spacing. The maximum device spacing allowed just in front of and behind the paver would be 120 feet divided by 2 for 60-foot device spacing. Single spacing of the devices would be appropriate ahead of the paver to allow for truck access. Let's take a look at this scenario as shown on the bridge deck rehab operation photograph. This project may take up to 1 month to complete. Let's go over the 4 factors. Knowing that the project will take a month, we will choose long-term stationary work with duration of more than 3 days to less than 3 months. This will give us 6 points. What is the exposure of the worker? Let's look at TC3A Table 1 for the work clear zone requirements. This roadway has a posted speed of 70 miles per hour for a work clear zone of 9 feet. That being the case, we would choose workers are expected to be inside the work clear zone for 10 points. Next, we know the posted speed of 70 miles per hour for 10 points. Factor 4, location of work. This is a bridge structure with drop-offs of 5 feet or greater with no escape routes for the workers for 10 points. Now we have 36 accumulated points. Let's look at the results. Positive protection devices are required in addition to standard traffic control and any other mitigation efforts. In this case, concrete barrier is required. Now that you are familiar with standard drawing TC3B, let's review this photograph of a dowel bar retrofit operation. Knowing that the accumulated points would fall within the 20 to 30 point range, what changes would be required to create a safe work zone? Since this is a moving operation, barrier would not be practical. The workers are working within the work clear zone, and their escape route is blocked by a truck and trailer. This being the case, a truck-mounted attenuator is required along with a reduction of traffic control device spacing by 1/2. A truck-mounted attenuator provides protection for occupants of errant vehicles through attenuating an impact that otherwise would be absorbed by workers' vehicle, in this case, a van. If the van is impacted, the van along with the impacting vehicle could enter the work activity area. To ensure that the workers are protected when using a truck-mounted attenuator, the required buffer space must be provided. The buffer space distance is the space between the protective vehicle and the work activity. It provides for a roll-ahead post-collision movement of the truck-mounted attenuator vehicle. In this case, the proper roll-ahead distance was used. This operation provides a clear open escape route for the worker. TC3B requirements have been met by the reduction of traffic control device spacing by 1/2. Keep in mind, it would be good practice to provide a truck-mounted attenuator as a shadow vehicle for additional protection for the worker. You have determined that the hazard is a Type D hazard, which is other objects that cannot be moved outside the astral clear zone, such as incomplete curbs, bridge parapets, barrier blunt ends, and poles. Is the hazard an incomplete curb? If yes, the curb must be delineated with traffic control devices. With this example, we have an island curb where the contractor did not have time to install a plowable end section, leaving a blunt end hazard. Delineating with traffic striping is not acceptable. Traffic control devices are required to delineate the hazard. If the hazard is not an incomplete curb, then the hazard must be protected according to Standard Specification 01554, which requires the hazard to be shielded within the astral clear zone for approach traffic by installing concrete barrier or other positive protection. This example, the light pole is protected by a sand barrel array. When using sand barrel arrays, you need to ensure that the edge of travel lane is located at a minimum 15 feet from the traffic side of the sand barrel array. This information is covered by Standard Drawing CC6. The unprotected barrier end is placed within the astral clear zone, creating a blunt end hazard for the traveling public. How would you provide positive protection in this case? Standard Drawing TC18 Detail B provides the solution. The detail requires a minimum of 40 feet of concrete barrier placed behind the existing W-beam guardrail. You need to make sure that the concrete barrier end is placed at a minimum of 3 feet behind the guardrail measured from the back of the guardrail post to the face of concrete barrier. This 3-foot distance will provide for the deflection of W-beam rail during an impact from an errant vehicle. Hazard Type E. Is the hazard within the work clear zone? If yes, is the hazard a vertical drop-off of 2 inches or less? If no, is the hazard a vertical drop-off of 6 inches or greater, or is the slope steeper than 4:1? If no, use the required traffic control devices. If yes, in addition to standard traffic control devices, use barrier according to detail TC3A2. Also see TC1 notes 17 and 18 for barrier installation requirements and table 2 for flare rates. Let's go into more detail regarding how to handle vertical drop-off hazards. The notes within the hazard mitigation chart tell us to use detail TC3A2 for vertical drop-off hazards. This detail instructs us how to deal with back slopes with vertical face steeper than 4:1 and how to handle fore slopes steeper than 4:1 or vertical excavations. Table 1, work clear zone, and table 2 for work zone flare rates for temporary barrier is also needed in order to properly deal with Type E hazards. In most circumstances, to avoid issues with Type C hazards, positive protection for workers, you will need to place the channelizing devices outside twice the work clear zone. If the hazard is less than 2 inches, we need to ask, is the traffic permitted to cross the vertical grade separation? If no, traffic control devices are required to delineate the travel path. In this case, workers will be working within the work clear zone as the next layer of asphalt is placed. That being the case, Type C hazard will need to be addressed. Your accumulated points will fall within 20 to 30 point range, requiring positive protection devices or other mitigation efforts such as reducing the traffic device spacing to 1/2. If the hazard is less than 2 inches, we need to ask, is the traffic permitted to cross the vertical grade separation? If yes, the W8-11 uneven lane sign will be required at maximum 2-mile intervals. Let's explore detail TC3A2 for vertical face or slopes steeper than 4:1.
barrier is required unless the backslope is a smooth uniform surface of suitable material to remain stable and not spall at speeds and heights shown.
In this case, if barrier was not placed, an errant vehicle could potentially climb the slope and roll.
For vertical excavation or slopes steeper than 4:1, barrier is required within the work clear zone.
For example, if you have a posted speed limit of 60 miles per hour with a work clear zone requirement of 8 feet, the 8-foot measurement is taken from the edge of travel lane towards the hazard. Since the remaining shoulder has a width of 4 feet, barrier is required. Here you have a shoulder width of 10 feet, effectively placing the travel lane outside the work clear zone, which requires the use of traffic control devices. If the vertical drop-off is greater than 48 inches, you must obtain approval from the region traffic engineer regarding the traffic control device and barrier requirements.
Let's examine this concrete barrier setup. If the vehicle impacts this system, the vehicle would travel behind and beyond the system, causing the vehicle to roll. In order to fix this problem, the barrier would need to be extended past the vertical drop-off and meet the barrier length of need requirements. According to the roadside design guide, the barrier is set up correctly, along with the required length of need. As you can see, the barrier is extended past the vertical drop, and the proper recovery area has been provided alongside and behind the end treatment. It is important that the length of need is met in order to protect the hazard. The length of need can be less than and combined with the buffer space requirement. Look at this example of the barrier length of need falling within the buffer zone requirement. The flare rate is designed so that if an errant vehicle should run into the barrier, it would be safely redirected into the travel lane. In this example, the length of need calculation is 159 feet. The posted speed limit is 65 miles per hour, and according to TC3A Table 2, the flare rate requirement is 18:1. TC4A requires a 645-foot buffer space. As you can see, the barrier length of need fits inside the required buffer zone. You have the option to install the barrier without a flare, but if you do so, the length of need will increase to 231 feet. Now you should be familiar with the TC3 series standard drawings and have a basic knowledge of how to handle hazards found in work zones. For additional information, please contact the UDOT Traffic and Safety Division.